set the scene. Sherman set the Wayback Machine for 1987. It was January. Degrassi Junior High premiered, and for the first time, teens and tweens, probably now a little older, saw themselves on screen on a week-to-week basis, dealing with stories that mattered to them and issues they could relate to. Over the course of two series and a TV finale film, we got to know these characters. We got to know their hopes, their dreams, their triumphs, and their heartbreaks. And we just wanted them to be our friends. We saw ourselves in them. Over the past couple years, Sue and I have had the privilege and luxury of getting to know some of these Degrassi people. They are not like their characters, but they are the friends you would want and expect them to be. And we want to introduce them to you right now, don't we, Sue?
Woo! We do! Woo! These guys are all standing out just on the other side of that door, waiting for some indication that they should come inside. So why don't we make some noise, let's get loud, let's welcome the cast of Degrassi.
Kids of Degrassi Street, I played a character named Lisa on that, so a completely different character. I don't know how many of you actually saw that show. Is that right?
I've never seen it.
Nope.
That's okay, Stefan. They asked us after that show ended how many of us wanted to play a new character or if we wanted to keep our old characters onto the new show they were doing. Only one of us decided that they wanted to keep their character. All of us wanted to try a new character. So
who was that one person that wanted to keep his character?
That was John. I didn't
want to. John, yeah.
Alex.
Alex.
Oh, and Alex.
Alex.
That's right.
But you also had to kind of re-audition.
So we did, and yeah. I re-auditioned, but I actually auditioned for a bad girl. I wanted to play a bad girl on the show. Her name was Annie, and I think that character was really short-lived. I think she was on for like one season. And nobody remembers it. I shouldn't say, I don't know.
Maybe Jimena remembers it. Didn't she play Annie?
Who, sorry?
Jimena.
Yes, that was her name. And it was a very cool character. Good job, Stephen. Round of applause for Stephen. They actually had me as Amanda. I don't think a lot of people know this, but I was actually playing a character they'd written called Amanda for the first like few episodes of Degrassi Junior High, and I was like hardly in that at all. And then they changed their minds and kind of came up with a better character named Caitlin Ryan, and the rest is history. And I loved that character so much better, so that was awesome.
Fake name. How about you, Dan? How did you get on the show, actually?
I was like this close to actually taking a job in the city of York as a caretaker at York Memorial Collegiate. Memo? And I was about ready to give up on acting. My agent who who I hadn't heard from in like 2 years, said, I have an audition for you for this some kids show. Would you like to go and do it? And I went down and auditioned for it. And when they called and said that I got the job, a letter arrived from the city of York offering me a second interview as the caretaker. Or memo. And
it was, have a backup plan.
Yeah, well, it was close. It was a tough decision.
Who wants to go next? You, Steph?
Okay. So also, you have to understand, like, when we were auditioning back then, it was not like a workshop. So it's like you were put in a room with like 30 other dudes, 30 other kids, girls and guys. And we had our initial auditions. The only roles to audition for were, I think, Joey Jeremiah, Yik Yu, Stephanie Kay, and
Arthur.
But so there was these characters that existed, but they were looking for other cast members as well. Mr. Garcia? What? What's with that teacher cameo today?
It's Mr. Garcia. Yeah.
Not my plan at all.
If only there were other Degrassi cast members in the crowd.
Mr. Garcia's a pimp now. workshops.
Right, so we had workshops. And to get in there, you had either audition for Joey, Stephanie. I auditioned for Joey Jeremiah. I did not get the role. Basically, I think they already decided that I was going to be Joy Jeremiah when he walked in the room. But I was so good. So they decided that they wanted to bring me back to see, as they did with a lot of kids, to see if they could write roles around who we were. It's the smartest thing you can do on a really super low budget show. And they did the same with Amanda walked in with her spiky hair. They're like, I guess we'll call her Spike. So I just remember that it went on for like a couple weeks, did it not? The workshop process, and it's like 2 weeks. And we all knew at the end of the 2 weeks, you were going to be given an envelope. This is crazy.
Yeah.
You were going to be given an envelope to tell you whether or not you fitted into the playing time repertoire. And we'd be a part of the show called Grassi that we would be shooting this summer. And everyone got one, but some people knew they weren't going to roll a show, including myself. I knew, like, they'd stopped doing anything with me. I just sort of sat in these workshops and had a pat, like, you know, breakdance against someone, some other guy that wanted to be doing. I don't know, but it was like, there was nothing left for me to do. I basically, that last day, I remember sort of resigning myself to the fact that I was not on the show, and I left, and I remember Kit came out after me. He's like, we all had these envelopes, and I wasn't sure if it was supposed to, like, if you had a fat envelope or a thin envelope, I don't know, but I left, I was upset. And he came after me and said, so Stefan, listen, well, before you leave, I'm like, yeah. But, do you play an instrument by chance? I'm like, I play a violin in school, I suck. He's like, okay, all right. Well, we'll see you next week. I'm like, oh, I'm like, okay, all right. I was convinced that I wasn't going to be involved in the show. I wanted to get away from these people because they were all like hugging each other. And, like, I probably ran back into certain people. I'm here. the cast got their roles that way. We were sort of discovered along the way.
And Kirsten?
So for me, I came on a little bit later than these guys. So believe it or not, I watched a lot of Degrassi before I even got on the show. And there was an autograph session. I don't know if any of you were there. I certainly was. And at the ROM, at the Royal Ontario Museum, and I showed up with a couple of girlfriends, and we lined up to get Degrassi signatures. And as I was getting signatures, our publicist at the time, I guess for the show, said, hey, have you ever done any acting before? And I said, no. And she said, well, you know, we're having auditions in a couple of months, and here's my number, give us a call.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Walking into, like, I walked into the soap shop.
And so that's what we did. Then I sent in my picture, they called me in, and once again, my character evolved over the years. I started as more of an extra in the backgrounds and, you know, seeing Joey naked in the cafeteria scene. And then it sort of stemmed. Yes, and they don't have them. Yeah.
So what you're saying is that all these people could potentially be on the grass.
Let's also keep in mind the rules are a little different then. Just pick some kids off the street, they'll be stars.
You have to get an envelope.
Yeah. Well,
Well, quite simply, because my story is very similar to Stefan's, where we were basically workshopped for weeks. I remember being in high school. I was in grade 9, and the principal came on the PA and said, we have some flyers here for a TV show that the CBC is doing. If anybody's interested and would like to audition for the show, please pick up a flyer and fill it out. And that was over the intercom. And I just remember kids in my class scoffing at CDC.
I'm all global, yo.
Yo. And I was just like this keener that I was really interested in. I went down and I picked up the flyer and my dad helped me fill it out and he sent it in. And about a week later, I got a phone call saying that I was allowed to come in and audition for the show. And they told us years or months later that about 500 kids across Toronto auditioned for the show, and only 50 or so were chosen for the workshop.
Yeah, so like our background, our like with extras background players were part of this company as well. So they didn't, like, there was no guarantee of having lines or anything like that, but they. That's one cool thing about Degrassi is that you see familiar faces all the time. They were there the whole time because
they were part of the ensemble.
Yeah, there's always an opportunity maybe to get a line here or there or more.
Yeah. So that's kind of how we all got into the show.
Yeah, and we still had to go, I still had to go through all the workshops as well, everyone from the original show. So everyone was nervous because nobody knew who was going to, no one was guaranteed a part.
No, but you could also, I remember at the time I could tell who I was being
groomed for.
No. No, I can tell who I was drawn towards as far as like Pat. I was like, that kid is really good.
That's nice.
But I want to be friends with the guys that are good, you know. And it's like I want to be friends with them. I want to be.
Pat's friend.
They saw relationships building during the workshop.
I think they saw that. Yeah. I was like, I do.
Yeah.
Another thing you gotta know about Kirsty, I want to say this also. I've really been trying to call you by your own name. We never called Kirsty. I don't think once I called her that. Her name on the set was Doug.
Doug, good.
Doug. And the reason was there were too many K names on set already, I think was
what
it was.
Yeah.
And someone just said, well, let's call her Doug.
Kirsten, Kristen. Yeah.
And everyone just calls her Doug, like producers. And this is the best part. The best part is she never said it. She's like, totally cool. Never complain. Just like, that's great. Whatever you want.
Years after the show ended, after we filmed Schools Out, Kirsten and I were driving in Toronto. She was in her car and I was in my car, and I noticed her. And I hadn't seen her in a few years, and I literally rolled the window down. And I went, Doug.
Now, Dan, you were the only adult on camera for most of the series.
Yes.
So, as the teacher slash parental figure about, did that role transcend the screen and be the big boss at offset? I mean, did you look after the kids? What did you do?
Hell no!
He was like hanging with us.
I was working in radio as well at the time in Hamilton. And so these guys thought it was kind of cool that I knew who all their favorite musicians were and who their bands were. I would just get feedback from them. So what do you think about New Kids on the Block? Did you hear the new song? What do you think? You know, I was hanging with them. Because the adults that were there when we were not filming all swung into action. Because the adults were there to light the set and bring in the booms and bring in the lay down track. So then all the adults were busy. And I had to hang out with the kids.
So, had to.
Yeah, I was relaxed with you guys. And so really, I just sort of hung out with Laura, their tutor, and distracted her from teaching them anything.
Trying to get us to do rug hooking and
We had to rug hooking, play a lot of Risk.
Dan was a big kid himself, though, back in the day.
Yeah.
We never took you too seriously.
Thank you.
I've been told I have to show this.
Is this like the emotion of my future?
What does it say?
It says,
radish attitude with Drake feelings. And what does the back say, Stefan?
What's that?
What does the back of the shirt say? Show us your booty.
Be calm. Be calm. It's a glass.
Hopefully now I will sold more than one.
I don't pay for it.
I'm down. I'm hurting on this one.
You're doing good.
Now, this is kind of your first big con for all of you. I mean, Pat, you've done some, you know, comic book cons in the past because you're a huge comic book collector.
Yep.
But I mean, and Dan, you've done tons of car things.
Yes.
I spoke years on your show.
Yes.
Is there any cross-pollination anywhere along there? I mean, how are all of you finding this weekend? I mean, what's...
There's no cross-pollination between my job and series and Degrassi fans.
No, wait a second. You had a couple of people that like you saw at your...
Like two or three.
Yeah.
Two or three. No one is asking to sign their glove box here. or a collector license plate.
Okay.
But are you guys having fun? Are you enjoying ComiCon this weekend?
Oh, yes. This has been great.
Yes.
It's my first one.
I'm actually trying to talk to
people. And yeah, we were at
That's my favorite. Just aside from meeting, like all of you.
Everyone's been so amazing, by the way. Like
this
honestly.
Has been so much fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We are certainly not tired of doing this.
All of you that have come and all of you that have come up to speak with us, you basically just reassured what I was hoping would happen, and that was in October when I approached these guys. I said, I think the timing is right. We're celebrating Degrassi's 25th anniversary of School's Out and the show's 30th anniversary. I think it's time that we make an effort to get together and give you guys an opportunity just to say hi, shake a hand, take a photo. And you guys have been there all these years, and we feel like we've grown up with you guys as well, because we've been part of each other's lives for three decades in one way or another, either be it with junior high or next generation or next class. And we hope that you guys keep watching or at least introduce the show to your kids one day.
And a lot of you have, which is so
which
cool.
Which is awesome.
And thanks for sharing your stories. We've heard a lot of funny stories. We've heard a lot of emotional stories. Mm-hmm. And it all means something to us, too, because we did grow up together, a lot of us, not all of us, different generations here, but we grew up alongside most of you, and it's a really cool feeling. So
I think it's really nice that we are, most of us at an age, where, I mean, it's nice that we have younger fans of the original Degrassi, but we are at an age where it's not as embarrassing to be a fan of Degrassi, because you found Degrassi, and then you're related to it, and then you went, oh my god, I relate to it. And that was not a pleasant feeling when you had to go back to school. It's like, I don't know, he's a weirdo. Wet dreams. But I think what has changed, it's so nice, and I think you're right, Pat, as far as time going by, and why it's the right time, is that you know, maybe 10, 15 years ago, if you're walking down the street, and like on Queen Street, and like people just like screaming, like, Snag, you suck! You know? But those same guys, 15 years later, like, a guy came up to me, I'm like, oh, this guy's gonna be trouble. And he's like, he came up to you, he's a little slosh, and he came up, he's like, fucking Snake, right? So,
I just wanted to see how she signed that.
And he came up and he was like, he's a baser guy, so he's wearing a suit, and he's looking all slick, he's on a date. And I'm like, oh, wait, he's gonna try to impress, like, that's a thing that happens, was to impress the girls, he's gonna come on the top round. And he comes up and just wants you to know, that show saved my life. And I was like, what? No. What? I was having a bad time in Vancouver, came, it's like, it was really important to me, I just want to say thank you. I was like, I'm flabbergasted, I don't even know what to say, because that's not, my defenses are usually up for that sort of thing. And it was the exact opposite, it was like, we all got old, didn't we? We could actually sort of like talk about what those things were and pass down all our insecurities to our children. Anyways, it is, I think what you're saying, Pat, is a nice time to be a fan of the show.
You know? Absolutely. Especially, it's Canada's 150th. We're so lucky to live in a country that lets us tell stories like we did on Degrassi.
It's
we're never censored.
How true that is.
It's so true. Just so proud of to be a small part of that pop culture history of Canadian television, and I think it is something to celebrate. We should be proud of what we've created here in Canada, and we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you guys being so loyal and really getting it and
sharing your stories,
sharing your
connecting to the characters that we played for so many years.
You know, Sue, I'd love to hear from you because you've been so quiet. I'd love to hear what you have to say.
I'm listening to you go on.
Never shut up.
one quick thing before we turn it over to the audience questions. Kirsten, so the first time I watched Schools Out as a younger person, to me, Tessa was the villain. Joey was the idiot. And Tessa was the ultimate villain of that movie. Watching it more recently as an adult-ish type person, there were some poignant, you going to the abortion clinic by yourself, no friends, no family, to me it turned into this like, the line, you have no idea what you've done, Joey Jeremiah. I was just like, that killed me as an adult. I'm like, what happened? Like, we were telling this powerful story and I was just mad at him for, you know, asking Tessa Campanelli.
Most people see that.
My quick question is, do you guys think Joey ever would have found out about that baby?
Talk about it all the time.
We do, because on the final, on Schools Out, the amazing part is the last scene you do see Tessa, is she walks into the abortion clinic and says, I'm here for my appointment, and that's it. So you never actually see her go into the appointment. I'm at the reception desk. So it was always sort of left as, did she actually go through with it? Is there a little Joey Jeremiah running around somewhere? Right? Yeah. They see her, most I think see her as a character that broke Joey and Kate Knapp that had this amazing relationship for so many years that people really felt was really real. And then Tessa comes along, but poor old Tessa actually really loved him too.
I never thought Tessa was the bad person in this. I mean, and also by standards, that's the hero. The person that's like, I don't care, I'm not gonna stop until I get the guy I want. Like that female lead on that show is the one that's like, look, she knows what she wants. You know,
she's just like, I did great at these two.
Tessa got the short end of the stick.
I think so.
For sure.
She's Degrassi's life loser.
He never hears about the abortion. Yeah. He's like, sayonara. Yeah. It's like, it's all fine. You know, she has to walk away from being a spunky young girl who wanted the boyfriend that she wanted.
Yeah. Didn't get him and didn't tell him.
I think where the villain part of Tessa Campanelli came from is, remember when Spike and her were having that conversation at the photo mat? And Spike said to Tessa, I don't think they've broken up, I just think they had a fight. And then Tessa says, well, I don't care, I'm going back to Degrassi as his girlfriend. And I think that one line gave the fans that watched Schools Out, like, oh, so she is a villain.
I don't understand the song.
Technically, I think Joey was the villain.
Joey spent the summer dating Kaylin.
I meant to say victim. Because he just wanted to love.
Yes. I agree, but he, when it came down to it, he knew he was going to end up with Kaylin, and this was a really surefire way of having sex. And he knew exactly what he was doing, and he just didn't know. Not you, Pat. And he just didn't know what he was, the lies that he was hurting, you know? And it's like, I project like Tessa that, like, up to this point, he basically dated Johnny Young.
And thank you.
Smoked some cigarettes. What you've done in like a very short period of time to prove what exactly you were. So you were like, oh, they gave you this kind of a heavy thing. I don't think a lot of people saw it coming. And it's kind of hard to play the girl that wants it all when she's not really considered the hero. You know, you were bound and screwed over.
Yeah. Were you guys blown away by the F-bomb when Snake said that? Were you sitting there with your parents watching Schools Out?
Schools Out is the biggest F-bomb ever. It's so incredibly sad to end a show that way. It's not like I've ever seen a show where all ends just like, so you're like, well, you know what? Columbo, you were a great detective, but you get out of here and be retired. Okay, like it's people going blind and killing babies and everything going on. It's like all your heroes, all these people, like, that was my best friend at Degrassi.
But it ended it with a wedding.
Oh, then you know it was gonna fail. The sign of Alexa. That man was over 3 years.
That's kind of a Shakespearean tragedy.
Totally. Yeah. And the only thing we had, the only thing you get at the end of that special is Joey and Kaylin have one last dance.
All right. It's a Gowan, right?
Yes, Gowan.
No, who played the last song?
Was it Harum Scarum? They were in Harum Scarum. Yeah, Harum Scarum was in it too.
You guys had Gowan.
I mean, you guys had a song on Gowan.
They had like criminal.
We didn't play them on our radio station.
No more tea.
Okay, I just watched it.
I think I got the last line in the movie, though, didn't I?
The last line.
I think I said, "May I have this dance?" To Spike.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have to go back and watch it. Yeah. I've got radish.
I just watched it recently.
I want to open up to the floor because we don't have a lot of time. I want to give these guys a chance to ask this question.
Because I feel like we need 2 hours to do this.
I don't just have everyone over.
You're here with the awesome.
Let's stand up or not?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Hi, this is Stefan. As a longtime Degrassi cast member, you were there from the ages of what, 12 in the beginning, 13?
13, I think, was my first year, yeah.
Yeah. What advice do you have for the current cast of young actors and actresses about the business of entertainment and how to handle it?
Well, I think that for the most part, you have to keep in mind what we were doing back then was only the best, most coolest, super awesome summer job in the world. It wasn't supposed to last 2 years. We were doing this thing that we're like, I love these people, are really cool. It's like, and then the show wrapped, and back then I think we had to wait like freaking 6 months for the show to come to the actually air. And it was a mistake that it was a hit. It was like, I think we were early, it was the Fresh Prince or something, and it was...
No, we were Sundays.
Sundays?
And if there was anything CBC Sports was doing, like left-handed lesbian curling, we got...
Everyone check that back, by the way. I can't remember if there was a lead in or not, but I just didn't think anyone was going to watch it. Like, it's a show where the dad doesn't come in at the end and tell you, look, we'll go get the test together, and everything's going to be fine. It's like, no, you go and your friends go, don't get the test. Go and just, like, you're fine. Don't worry, you know this. It's like that kind of show where you have to go through the shitty part alone because a lot of kids go through the shitty part alone. So needless to say, we're kids that just... We're brought in a very special way. I like to think that we all had our own special acting talents.
But you consult the new kids now, right?
Well, you're talking about. Now the difference today is first of all, they have the ones that are serious. By the time they get into a Degrassi audition, they have an agent. They have supporting parents who are not pushing them into this, that they are letting them follow their dream. They are, our cast especially now, we were actually, I think when we were doing Degrassi Junior High, it was probably about what, 5 days an episode? Maybe, like, how many days did we have to shoot an episode?
5 days of filming, 4 days of rehearsals,
so 5 days of filming.
Our show, as a lot of people probably don't realize, was non-union when we were shooting.
Oh, they didn't realize.
Of course you
do.
It's gone budget.
But the difference was, though, that we were sort of going along for the ride and had to learn the rules as they went along. They were very strict with us, and you know, by season three, Pat was drowning. And we were all like sort of like going along. No, I'm just saying, we're now known for this show, but I don't know if we, the only way we had to keep our head straight and try to like, you know, expand into the next level of our career was just to go, I don't know what we're doing, but I hope it turns out okay. Now they have plans when they're going into this because they don't want kids. The worst thing you can go to is an agent that doesn't have a plan for you. And I would just say that it's very important to be humble about what your abilities are. No kid comes on Degrassi that first year and is awesome. They leave that show freaking awesome. It's the best acting school in the world. And it's like one of these things where the day they show up, we go, this is a real job, guys. It's like, yeah, you know, you're 16, but you got to know your lines. We shoot now an episode in 2.5 days. And I would tell you, you're going to get 2 takes. So you better know your lines. It's usually more about 5 takes, but it's like, it's one of those things we want them to. And the cast have always been good, but with the cast now are these young people that wanted to be actors because they watched Degrassi. And now they're going to get a chance to actually audition for Degrassi. And the stakes are so high, it's very hard to watch them sometimes. I audition them and it's, you know the ones that are, sometimes you don't know the ones that are going to be genius. We had this kid named Eric who plays on the Mess Class, who I thought was like kind of just like, I thought he was kind of like, sort of handsome young Ross from Friends. And he came in and played on his guitar. And then he left, and I was like, and the rest of the you know people auditioning are all ladies. I was like, so he could be kind of like the nerdy best friend. They're like, are you fucking kidding? He's a like, stud. He's amazing. I wish I had a boyfriend like that. I didn't recognize that. Point being, they come in, that kid is an amazing, like, he's almost like a savant when it comes to the way that he finds that role. And that comes from him working hard. I don't know what else to say, except you gotta work hard, and you can't pretend that, like, it's like the saddest thing we've all ever watched is those first rounds of Canadian Idol, where it's like, I'm gonna be a star, my mother says so, I'm gonna be famous. And it's like, they had nothing to back it up except they sing in the house, and you gotta go and sing with a teacher, and you gotta, like, take those lessons. And all those kids, the best thing is, and it reminded me of us a lot also, they want to be reporters and they want to be like dancers and like they want to run track and they just do things that are not about them, but they do it with such commitment. And we all had those dreams also, or like other things that we wanted to discover. There's a certain type of kid, and it sounds really silly because it's just acting, but you've got to come in with an attitude that it's not about me, it's about us, and then we all succeed. It's a really weird thing to tell a kid that. Because usually they're watching the show where it's like, I'm punky. Or that's what's more recently, I don't know, but now
you
can
find it. You had manners since it started.
But that's only advice I can have. It's like,
it's take it seriously. It's a real job. It's not something that just happens. You don't deserve it. You have to earn it.
Those kids are, they don't tell you.
See how I did that in like 10 seconds?
Give time. Anyways, yes.
I have a question for Snake and Mr. Radich, and then for all of you.
You sure you want to ask Snake?
Yeah.
Now for Snake and Mr. Radich. What was it like working with Drake in the early years of
Degrassi? Pat worked with Drake too. Pat and Stacie were on
What was it like? And do you guys get free concert tickets? You know, like Mr. Radich would be the Drake's bodyguard. Like,
Where's my
horse? No, Mr. Radich could be Drake's bodyguard.
Yeah.
You know, like he could be his entourage.
So
And will there ever be a Degrassi reunion with the original cast members?
This is it.
This is like the behind the scenes notes.
Like I think, wheels.
Well, I mean, wheels are wheels.
Yeah.
Okay, well, listen, the whole point is that you have to realize a lot, this is so special. Because when I talk to the kids today about old Degrassi, they're going, oh my god, I just saw it the other day, it's the same set, and Drake was so young. That's as far as their history goes, and you know, there was something else. So there's an audience for it, but it's always a strange discovery for them. I don't know if there's really, I mean, there is an audience for this, I know it, but it's like it's, I don't know if we're interested in telling those stories right now either, I mean.
Also, you know, we've all moved on. I think, you know, Kirsten is now a school administrator. Stacie's a mother of two young children. Dan has been filming in Los Angeles for 13 years, his own TV show. There's really no need to bring us back as a classic.
So funny,
yeah. And we don't know where Mr. Garcia is anyway. But in our own way, doing this tour across country allows us an opportunity to give you guys a what's up with us and what have you guys been up to.
Woo!
Thank you guys. Yeah. Thank you so much.
I already have a story idea from Pat myself, and I'm sure that Christy Stacie came up with really that we're going to start pushing down. It's like, this was an awesome adventure just to go, wow, those are dumb ideas that we're making a TV show.
Over here with Black Hat.
Hey guys.
Hey girl.
Hi. Hi. You guys. I just want to know, what was your favorite scene shooting? Like, what was your best scene and what was your worst scene?
Oh, that's hard.
I think, okay, so I don't know if any of you remember the Degrassi Junior High where the school was on fire.
Yes.
I was in black and white plaid dress chasing Clint Ted in the school at my grading dance. And we were meant to touch. We were meant to go to the door, and back then we had some pyro, you know, behind the door flames, and there was fire people on site because they were supposed to light, and it was supposed to appear that the door was on fire. So Tessa was to touch the door handle, and ouch, it's hot. So we did a couple takes, and sure enough, third take, ouch, it's hot. And I actually opened the door, and the door was actually on fire. So our full faces were, so that was probably one of my most memorable. Another one would be in School's Out, Joey and I had a scene on the couch, which actually, yeah, and filmed in Stefan's real house, because they used his house as Tessa's house. Stefan's real couch is a fun fact, too.
Legacy.
I had to go home with the couch every day. So I got less action than they did in my house.
So we film the scene, and all of a sudden my parents come home, so I throw him off, and he goes running down the stairs, and actually as he's going down the stairs in one of the takes, and if you watch School's Out, you'll see this scene, because they kept the scene, and he falls, and Joey hits the wall and knocks down pictures, completely not supposed to happen,
my mother's
falls down the stairs. Yeah, and I turn around, and I'm not facing camera now, I'm watching Joey leave, and I'm laughing. You can actually see the shoulder. And then they directed to yelling, roll camera, continue, roll. I'm thinking, I gotta turn around now and look shocked. My parents are there, and I'm dying of laughing. So I turn around, and you almost see me snicker in the scene, so there's a bit of a secret there, maybe, because I'm really trying to hold it together. So that was probably one of my favorites.
You're awesome.
I think, again, also in School's Out, it was kind of my best and my worst scene experience. We had to go, I went from having to be like super happy because Joey tells Caitlin that, I think it's when he proposes, he gets the ring and everything, so she's like super happy. And then the director, because it was the same room, he wanted to turn around and go right to the scene where she's bawling and freaking out because she found out that he was cheating on her. And no, it was the other way around. I just did like the bawling scene, I think. So I was like, and then we were gonna have to do another crying scene because you know how she like screams at him and then she goes into the room and she's like bawling. So I was all like getting myself all worked up to do that, and then I found out this is how it was. The director wanted to change it because of the lighting or something, and he wanted to do the happy scene. So I was all ready to be like bawling and crying, and he said, "Oh, okay, so we're gonna do the scene where you're so over the moon and happy," and I was really upset. I was just like, so the producer was like, "Okay, well, I'm gonna talk to the director and let's just do the scene." And he had words with me of that, because he was like, you know, you're going to find out as you get older and more professional that they can't always accommodate you for these kind of things. I was just like, hmm.
I've only been doing this for 10 years.
But whatever, so they did it, it was fine. But so, and it was a good scene, I liked the scene, I was happy with it, but I had to deal with that in my head then from now on, so I guess I'm not a professional actor.
It was tough, you know. They really sometimes just to get us upset on camera, they would get us upset in real life. They would always say to me, "Pat, we're gonna fire you." I'm like, "No, Pat, they mean that. Oh, camera."
That wasn't to make you upset. We meant that every day.
Yeah,
testing cars. You can't like.
It was. I signed the petition. Next question. I want to hear another question.
We're on the far side.
So Degrassi dealt with a lot of really heavy issues. I'm wondering what each of you thought was the most important and pivotal episode or issue that you guys dealt with.
Good question. Good question. For me, I think the AIDS topic that we dealt with was pretty serious, and it was a good time to tell that story.
AIDS and suicide.
Yes. Suicide.
Yeah. For sure. Yeah.
You guys?
Well, I'm still in a different way where, like, you know, we do go back to stories over and over again because there's probably like five things that happen to each of you, you know? And one of the things I looked at, because I loved it so much though, was looking back at, so Snake's brother was gay. That's as far as we could go, as far as having a gay character at Degrassi at the time.
In the 80s.
In the 80s, it was like kind of crazy that we were even having a conversation. And I don't know if you remember the episode, but Snake's brother's basically vanished from the family, and
that was it.
And then you jumped ahead to Next Generation, and we watched Marcos coming in, which is a very different experience. And he's at the school, and he's telling his friends that he loves, and now we're in the school. And then you can jump ahead another 10 years to like Tristan, who that character was introduced as fabulous. You know, he's out. And it's like watching the transition of a specific storyline means a lot, that we had to have Snake's brother and that terrible, you look back, you're like, people are fucking awful.
Yes.
And it's like, but to get where we are with these stories today, so sort of like, that's a storyline I really enjoy.
And now you're transgender, you're doing...
Well, yeah, it's like, but I mean, the world keeps opening up in ways that we have to look at, and it's, we're always trying to be 3 years ahead. I remember we were like, I remember Linda, Schuyler, was saying, if we're going to do a transgender character, I need you to convince me that there are transgender kids watching this show. And we're like, welcome to the internet. And so it's like we're always expanding, but that's definitely the next steps of, you know, where we go with Degrassi. And that's I don't know if that makes a lot of sense, but that's how I look at the storylines. That storyline, that topic always got me as far as very true Degrassi.
Cool.
Very nice.
Cool.
Anything else?
Yeah, I don't really have a question so much as a request. Whether or not either now or even more practical at the end of the show, whether or not Pat and Stefan would be able to sing a little bit of the...
I will do it if the audience doesn't
yes.
give us the end of the show.
So, Pat's going to do it.
I'll do it.
Later. You're here.
She grew up watching Degrassi Junior High, and then she introduced me to the Next Generation. And I know she was really thankful because it opened up the door for her to talk to us when I was a kid about rage.
Are you looking back at your mom to make sure that she agrees?
My mom was like, Brenda, why did you have to like point to me? So you guys really helped open the conversation for my mom to introduce things to us and like have that dialogue. A lot of those things are hard to talk about. I can only imagine hard to act. So, was there any storyline in particular that was really emotional for any of you guys to really see, whether it was Craig dealing with bipolar or, mm-hmm. you know, like you mentioned your brother? I just want to know, each one of you, which one was kind of hard for you guys to act or emotional?
That's a good question.
Yeah. You guys are trying to come up with good questions.
I mean, my take on it is like, what is hard, because we all wanted the scary stories. Yeah. You all want to be the one that's like going through that terrible thing, you know, and it sounds crazy. Because it's a competition between you. It's like, who's gonna, you know, get the big story this year? And then you get it, and you are suddenly realizing you have to do a little research and figure when your ass off to make sure that we do it right. That's all that show was about, was getting it right so that someone could watch and go, oh my God, I think I'm not alone.
I want to interject real quick. I do know that back in the 80s when we were doing the show, they were always looking at us. The producers, writers, directors, they were always looking at us and studying us and taking from our lives some experiences that we had dealt with. Sometimes they would pull cast members aside and say, listen, we're thinking about doing a storyline for your character of a rape story. And you know, are you even prepared to do something like that? You have a choice. You don't have to do it. I know for Neil's character, Wheels, they approached him after his real father passed away 6 months later and said, Neil, do you even think you can handle that? And Neil said, absolutely, I want that. I want to take on that storyline as a foreclosure, but also as an actor, I want to grow and be able to portray that. So yeah, they were always asking us.
They did that for me too, because they and my parents were divorcing. And there's a point where Caitlin's parents are thinking about separating, she's having an affair, the dad's having an affair, and they ask me too, they're like, you know, they study us, and they get a lot of their ideas from us going through stuff in our lives, and I was cool with that one.
I actually stole the set vehicle with the cast in it and took it for a joyride one day after work, and 6 months later, Joey steals a car with Snake and Wheels.
Snake's parents car.
I got banned from the bus for a month. But that kind of stuff would happen.
It's kind of, we also explain this to Joseph. They used to bus us in, you know, like to the set. So yeah, we were basically, and it wasn't a nice bus.
No.
They were bands that would break down on the DVD.
All these kids standing at the side of the railing like this.
Degrassi cast on the 401.
Okay, guys, we have time for one more question.
Uh-oh.
Sony needs a really, really good question. It's got to be really good.
Thank you, really good, guys.
Thank you.
Is it really good? Yeah? Is it good?
do you guys not have any major questions?
If you don't get a chance to answer your question, come to our booth and we can talk to us at the booth.
Hi, so I was actually not born until after school's out, but I started watching The Next Generation and then went back to rewatch.
Oh, cool.
And in the pilot episode, they actually pilot Caitlin sort of like dealing with some sexuality stuff, you know, like, you remember it? Like, so I was wondering if y'all had any thoughts about what would have happened if they had actually just carried that storyline through.
That would be brilliant. Of course,
it's so sexy.
Yeah.
She's having dreams. And yep. People that didn't know what or know which episode she's referring to. Caitlin has dreams of being attracted to Ms. Avery and she's questioning her sexuality. And yeah, that would have been cool if they had continued that on. I love that they kept it open-ended though. Like I love for Caitlin, like it was just like, okay, it's normal to be questioning your sexuality. And they never really, you find out that Caitlin's attracted to Joey for whatever reason.
If Caitlin was bi, school's out would have been a way better
Oh my God. Why did you say about this right now?
That
would have been amazing.
School's out. Oh,
yes, so
they did that with a few characters.
Radish wasn't the straightest.
Yeah, nobody really knew about me. And when Bruce McDonald directed on Next Gen,
right.
One of the storylines was a girl finding out that her father was gay. He was a broadcaster over in the UK,
right.
And he got married to another guy, and she was all messed up and being acting out of school, and then they brought her into, she had to come to my office because of her behavior, and they really did up the whole ambiguity. There was no wedding ring that I was wearing. There was a picture of me and another guy on a fishing trip, obviously, but we're just, you know, arms around each other holding a fish up. The tea and the doilies and all that kind of stuff. I thought it was great that they played around with that to the point where it didn't matter.
Right.
And that's
the way she did
it.
Doesn't it sound like Mr. Radish still?
You know, if I may add, before you wrap everything up and make us leave, I think that as fans of the show, you should be very happy about one thing, and that is that one of the original cast members of Degrassi Junior High is still at the helm and doing Series 4. It's very comforting to know that somebody who's there to see all that from the start is still there.
Thank you, Dan. The only thing I will say is that the writers on we are the latest version, next class on Netflix and
Amazon.
Don't
buy the shirt.
Not one of them has missed any episode of Degrassi. And they're our youngest writers are usually around like 23, 24. Our oldest are probably like in their late 40s and early 40s. They know the show inside out. There's such a legacy that's so important to us to make sure that the show is relevant. Like this past year, it was like, we have to do Syrian refugee kids.
Yeah.
We kind of have to. And it's like, that comes from a mindset of a super fan that's now a writer on the show. And what is that thing that has to be addressed? You know, I know we have a couple things coming up that are LGBTQ in the next season. That we're like, oh my God, if we don't do this, we're gonna be so far behind the curve. We've gotta get back out there. It's like, Adam, it's like, we have like, once we lost Adam, we gotta go back and like, see what the next step is. These are people that are in love with what happened those first couple of seasons on Degrassi, and it's like, there's a lot of people trying to keep the legacy alive. The nicest thing was when Linda watched episodes of the season, where she went, she turned around and editing, she's like, oh my God, it's Degrassi Junior High. And I'm like, I know, it's Degrassi Junior High. Oh my God, yeah, it's the storyline where one of our girls is learning to use a vibrator. And we're like, no, but we're like, it's totally you and it's
yes.
My dreams.
Yes.
Anyways, I really appreciate that, Dan. I think that there's a lot of importance in keeping up the legacy of something like Degrassi, always expanding and moving forward, but
groundbreaking.
We want to make sure you guys like feel it, you know. So
thank you. Bunch of moves in that salon.
Yeah.
We're on a live screen here, so thank you very much, everyone, for coming to ComiCon and for joining us for our first fan. appreciation tour.
It was so fun.
We love Toronto, and we love the fact that Degrassi has been part of your lives, and we appreciate the fact that we had a small part of that experience with you guys. And as the Joe Jeremiah and the Zit Remedy would say,
yeah.
Everybody wants something, they'll never give up. Everybody wants something, they'll take your money.
DegrassiTour@gmail.com
and we'll put those pictures up on the Degrassi Tour Facebook page.
Can I just say thank you, Comic Con, also for doing a good job.
And if anybody has a fan reaction or a little clip you would like us to know, we're going to be over just to the side of this room, to the right side.
Wait.
And,